One second. Oh, there's Max. Awesome. We're going to bring Max in. So this is Max Littman.
Nice.
He'll give you all of his credentials.
Oh,
We covered the
fun.
last two elections together, or not together, but you know. Max.
Tommy, great to hear from you.
Yeah, good to hear from you.
Max, nice to meet you.
So I gotta, if you want to give your credentials so that everybody in here is aware, we've been through a couple elections together,
Yeah,
but.
absolutely. Great to talk to you all. Like Tommy said, I'm Max. I am a professional political analyst. I cannot say who I work for because my boss does not like when I do that, but I can say it is a very large, major election decision company. I specialize in predicting elections, analyzing polls, doing all sorts of the behind-the-scenes stuff that will hopefully tell us who is going to win in November because a lot is riding on it.
Nice. So I want to hear. I have my thoughts that I've talked about pretty extensively on who the candidate needs to be for the VP. Apparently, Kamala is talking about announcing as early as Monday. I think someone said she's going to be in Philadelphia, which sort of leans Shapiro. I don't think that that's the correct choice, but I'm curious to know who you're thinking in this one.
Yeah, so there's a couple of schools of thought here. And first is my preference is different than what I'm going to say. To get that out, like I'm not a Shapiro guy. With that said, from what I'm hearing from the Harris camp, the reason Shapiro would be the pick is simply because if you look at the map, it gets very complicated without Pennsylvania. We know from political science that really the VP does very little outside of their home state, in which they actually do get a 1 to 2% boost most of the time. And obviously, there's an asterisk on that. Like, I don't think JD Vance will get any sort of boost in Ohio. With that said, I think the thought from the Harris team right now is that Pennsylvania is so valuable that Shapiro is worth it no matter what. And I think their calculus too is even if there's backlash at the end of the day, they can say he's the VP. He's not going to be the most visible person on the campaign, but they can just plant him in Pennsylvania.
Right. And so that's kind of the question, right? Shapiro is a great orator. He's probably the best in the race. There's a couple of issues, obviously. One, he's not particularly well vetted or not as well vetted as some of the other candidates. So there's potential for surprises. I don't think there will be, but there is a potentiality for them over other candidates. And the other thing that I was interested in is the polling that's coming out right now is showing Kamala up in Pennsylvania. There's been numerous different polls. So my thoughts on this are this: Pennsylvania is important. You can't win the race without it. However, doesn't necessarily look like they need Shapiro to do it. Beshear, though, does something for the Harris campaign that no other candidate does, which is he opens up the potentiality for Georgia to maybe move more towards Kamala, opens a potentiality for North Carolina. And so the money spread across the states becomes much more significant for the Trump campaign than if Shapiro's in the race. If Shapiro's in the race, sure, you're targeting three states, you're trying to win out in three states. If Beshear's in the race, you're probably already going to win Pennsylvania anyways. But now you have, Georgia, North Carolina, probably not Florida, but maybe enough to scare the Trump campaign to send resources there. And I think he speaks well to the Midwest already. If it's my pick and I was gonna pick someone, it would probably be Beshear. I would probably pick him 95 times out of 100 just because of the demographic that he opens up. And I think don't think Shapiro has that widespread of play, but it's gonna kind of depend because he is an amazing orator. And if someone's going to carry the message well, it's going to be him. So I don't know. If it's Beshear or Shapiro, they probably win either way. But
So I tend to agree with you on that, in that I think Beshear is the more exciting pick. I think from their calculus, look, if North Carolina and Georgia are in play, it's over. So it really depends. Are you trying to eke out a win, or are you trying to just play for the whole ball game? If you're trying to eke out a win and that's what you're most concerned about, you go Pennsylvania only. From my point of view, with our recent polling, it's not going to be particularly close. All things considered, right? Obviously, October surprise, whatever, whatever. The way things are trending, it's not going to be particularly close. So why not go for it? Swing for the fences, go for Beshear. A lot of people online are saying Tim Walz, the Minnesota governor. I think that's a fine choice. I don't think he's the most exciting choice out there. But again, like they're at a point where they can afford, I think, to kind of swing for it. Like go for it, do something exciting, get young people more involved instead of taking the
Right.
safe option with Shapiro.
Right. I think, well, that's the thing though, is I think that like, they have their cost benefit, right? Like if you're going to go with Shapiro, you're going to guarantee yourself Pennsylvania. You have to have that state. Like there's just not a way to do it. But if you bring in Beshear, the excitement level, and I think that Beshear just speaks to so many more, not even I think, he does, right? Because we have to be real about that. Shapiro is Jewish. How well is that going to play in the very Christian South? Don't know. How well is that going to play in Atlanta? Don't know, right? There's a lot of religious, predominantly black religious leaders there that are, you know, I don't know how that's going to play off. It may just go just fine. Maybe something that flies under the radar. But Beshear, that's not a hill that Beshear has to climb.
Beshear agree with that. It's somewhat disappointing, right? Like, obviously, we wish that that wasn't an issue. I'm Jewish myself. I wish it wasn't an issue. Right. I think it has to be a consideration. Right. I think the counter for that, and if it is Shapiro, why we should feel okay, is he is so remarkably well seen in Pennsylvania. His approval rating. I know a lot of people, like, the consensus is that young people don't like him. I really think it's just a process of this whole thing playing out online. And the more online types, he has a 63% approval rating in Pennsylvania. Someone likes him. A lot of someone's like him in his home state where he's actually well known. So I think, obviously, I don't want it to be the pick. But if it is Shapiro as the pick, you just got to run with it. And I think his approval rating is the difference maker there. But also, you look at Beshear, he has an incredibly good approval rating in Kentucky as well. He's really similarly strong in that same aspects.
Right. And I think that, like, and we've talked about this before, the more that you know about politics, the more you're removed from what other people, the normal American population, is thinking. And while, like, Shapiro is an incredible orator, right? Beshear has this innate ability to speak to people on a human level that is not, you know, really approachable. And I think in this instance, like, I think that VP pick is going to be a big deal, right? Like how Palin was, J.D. Vance is so bizarre, so weird, that we may see where this plays out and this becomes a big issue. Shapiro is a guy that's like, I'm the competent one, right? Against Vance. Beshear is a guy that can counter him in Appalachia. So I don't know if it's me, and I just, generally speaking, I don't think that Shapiro's policies are the future of the party. So for me, I think more like Shapiro is probably going to be president at some point. And I don't really want to put us in a situation like we have now where it's like Kamala is the significantly better option to Trump, but she's not really what the party represents, right? And I think avoiding that might be the way forward. Shapiro probably gives you a win, almost certainly does. I think it could target the Midwest pretty well. I just think Beshear, like, in the event that Trump ends up dropping Vance, because I think he's probably going to be forced to do it. I think that Vance is too much of a liability now. I know I'm taking a big stance.
I somewhat disagree, and I'll go why I disagree in a minute on that.
Yeah. I just think that, like, for Donald Trump, Vance is a liability. He's a significant liability. He only speaks to their base. He's not bringing any new voters. And the longer he's in the race, the more Shapiro and Kamala are going to solidify those undecideds. Donald Trump might not do it, but he's in a position where he realizes that if he loses this election, he's probably going to jail. And so I think he's desperate. I think that he's likely to drop. Because if I was in his position, ego aside, I'd drop him in a heartbeat. And the question would be,
I would never have picked him in the first place.
Right. So I think that from that perspective, like, Beshear is a guy that, like, even if the Republicans pick, right? Because this is my thought. Like, let's say for a second that the Republicans drop Vance and the Democrats pick Beshear. There's not a good counter for him, right? You have Burgum, who Donald Trump was considering. He's not going to target Appalachia. Nikki Haley isn't going to target Appalachia. Sure, she may target some of the Midwest voters, but the opening of that many more resources having to be delegated across the state is going to be significant. There's not really going to be a good response. And so that's why I'm leaning like Beshear, because Beshear in all, like, potential variables seems like the safe bet. Sure, Shapiro's going to give you Pennsylvania, but Beshear's like, there's nobody that can counter him. And I think that a VP in this instance, because of the way that this race has played out, is probably going to have more of an effect than previous ones, but we'll have to see. It is a wild, wild, crazy race at this point. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, my take on that is, I think if anything, the VP is exactly like you said, more scrutinized, because
we have a situation where the VP is stepping up to run for president. Like, just the nature of the situation has made it such that the VP is going to have so much more scrutiny than normal. As far as Vance, I think obviously the smart thing would be for Trump to drop Vance tomorrow, but he is running out of time. He has, I believe, under 2 weeks now before we have actual like ballot deadlines for that. So if it's going to happen, it almost parallels to like Biden dropping out. If it's going to happen, the sooner the better, and it has to be now for him. But I don't see it. The thing with Vance and why Vance was chosen is because he had Don Jr. and Eric's ear, and Don Jr. and Eric had Trump's ear and Peter Thiel's money. Trump drops Vance, he drops Peter Thiel's money probably, which especially with the recent fundraising from Kamala is absolutely essential. And then like, who do you pick? Burgum is incredibly boring. I mean, he'd be like a Pence type pick of who cares. He's not picking Nikki Haley because he hates Nikki Haley. I mean, what do you do? Like picking Kristi Noem? Like, I wish that'd be a 49 state blowout.
She would get eaten alive. I don't know who he picks. And that's, you know, that's a product of him just being kind of screwed right now. He can't pick someone. He'd have to pick a moderate, and I don't know how many moderates would be even. I mean, a Tim Scott's boring. I think that the other problem for him too is like, assuming he was to drop out, I think they have until the 20th is when the deadlines go in. They also have to do like a delegate reconvening. Doesn't specify, I don't think, how they're supposed to do that, so they could potentially do it by phone, but they have to reconvene delegates. It's a whole process. And when you have the heat of the Democratic convention going on, when are you going to get a news bump by dropping Vance? Like, you're going to give them a bump from the coming out of the convention, and then you're going to drop Vance, inherently drop that off. And then you got to introduce this new candidate. It's probably just going to fly under the radar. So I don't know but I feel like he might be that desperate right now, because the polls, I mean, she's made up what in favorability, 8 points in a week. Yeah. Like, it's not looking good for Trump, and I know, and I think he knows it at this point.
My go-to baseline for how Trump's doing is talking to I know people on both sides. Obviously, I'm on one side. I have very cordial relations with some people in the Trump camp, and I just, you know, monitoring how they're feeling. Until the day Joe Biden dropped out, they were on cloud nine. They were already planning what position they were going to have in the administration. They were locked in. And since then, it's been just full on panic mode. And this has been in the media too, of the Republican panic, because they just really, I don't think they think that the Democrats had the balls to do what they did. I don't think they thought Joe Biden was the tactician he was to strategically drop out. And they're terrified because they know that they have an unpopular candidate who's the oldest presidential nominee in history, who continues to get worse, who got zero bump from almost being assassinated. Like, if you remember the day of the assassination, people everywhere were saying, it's over. The Democrats lost. Trump's going to get this insane boost. And that never materialized. Joe Biden drops out, and all of a sudden, they're in just full-on panic mode. So I agree. If they do something drastic, it's because they're in a position where Trump's going to prison. They have to do something because they're getting alive right now.
I said this before. If Donald Trump drops Vance, he 100% believes he is going to lose. And that's why he would drop him. He believes he has no path forward. I don't know that he's going to do that. We'll see. I would drop him. But I think that, like, from the perspective of where we are in American politics, and the one thing I didn't see, and I don't think anyone saw this, was there are so many tropes that were attached to Joe Biden that it undermined his presidency, right? It undermined what he did. And to the point where it's like, oh, he got 1 million veterans health care. Oh, yeah, but he fell downstairs. And it's just like, then people that are in the middle, like, it's a wash. He's not coherent, but he got stuff done. And we don't know who to go for. Trump's crazy, whatever. And Joe Biden leaving the race, like, destroyed this entire infrastructure of tropes, of lines of attacks, of arguments. The list goes on. The Republicans are struggling on any capacity to find some line of attack against Kamala. And at the same time, they've been attacked and have been given this trope of being weird. That's now sticking, right? And it's just like, we don't have to have a conversation about whether or not January 6th was whatever, or whether this policy is crazy, or, you know, whether it's not crazy. We can just say, that's weird. And this trope sticks, right? And I think that, like, that seismic shift of just like, from going and having everything on lock, having a response to everything, Joe Biden being shut down left and right over just these tropes that people inherently believe, gone overnight. And it gave Kamala this amazing opportunity to enter the race where there's, she's like a Barack Obama. Nobody knows who she is right now. She's kept away for 3 years. Like, sure, we do, right? Like, we've talked about her pretty extensively on this, but most Americans are like, eh, she's been hid away for 3 years. And now they don't have any lines of attack against her. They don't have anything. And now just Donald Trump, when he says something, she's just like, eh, that's weird. Nothing's sticking because she can just shrug it off, right? Just don't give any breath to these lines of attack. And she's probably going to win. I think she's going to, I think there's a high likelihood she wins at this point. High likelihood.
Yeah. If you want to simplify it even down further, look at just Trump's nicknames, which I think is also a really good barometer of how stuff is. Sleepy Joe, for what it's worth, was effective, right? Like, he was old. He did make mistakes. He was sleepy. He didn't campaign a lot. And for Kamala, it's like Crazy Kamala, which plays awesome for women across the country who hate that. It's so clear that they have nothing on her because she's fresh. She's invigorating. I said this at the time when it became clear she was the nominee. The biggest thing is that she can go campaign every single day. We needed a candidate that can campaign at three stops a day in swing states in a way that the Democrats haven't seen since Obama, because Hillary didn't do that really. And Biden definitely didn't do that. We have this like perfect mix of a candidate who's invigorating, who's exciting, who can do that. I mean, she was in Atlanta today at a stadium with 20,000 people. When was the last time you saw Biden do that or any Democrat do that? It's something that Republicans are just utterly unable to replicate right now with Trump, and also unable to protect against.
Right. And nothing is it's just they don't. I mean, like, this is the whole point, right? Everybody knows the trope against Biden, that he's old, that he's senile. This is all inherently believed, right? And after the debate, just sort of confirm that for people that are in the middle. That's gone. They don't have that against Kamala. I mean, Democrats were very clearly, I think, desperate. And they were like, we need a different option. We're not going to do worse than we're doing right now, so we might as well try someone else. I didn't think it was going to be Kamala, I'm going to be honest with that. I didn't think she was going to be the one to emerge like this. I think she was the one that was going to have to be picked, but I didn't think she was going to see this kind of bump. This is crazy. This is like not predictable on any level. And the Trump camp is like in clear panic mode, and they should be. We see Georgia started moving closer towards Kamala. I don't know about North Carolina. I don't know if you've seen any polls, but the fact that she's tied in most swing states or in a statistical tie should be concerning for Republicans. And they're out here running around like, oh, look, yeah, she's going to lose. We're going to lose. I don't know. I think that November with Roe v. Wade, with the LGBTQ community, with Vance being a liability in Project 2025, I think the Republicans are in, and how well the Democrats have outperformed the poll, I think they're in serious trouble. I think that
100%.
Yeah, I think they're in serious trouble.
And the latest we have from North Carolina is we had a Trump plus one poll the other day. And if Trump is winning North Carolina by one point, Harris is winning. Like, she doesn't need North Carolina. If North Carolina is within one, we know that Georgia is probably blue. We know that Pennsylvania is probably blue. Even though they're different regions, we can still use that to ascertain that the closer North Carolina is, the better Harris is doing nationwide. And then also, I think a very salient point is that the fact that Kamala was able to coalesce everyone so quickly and get herself the nominee so quickly is indicative of why she is going to win. The fact that her team and herself were strategic enough to gather support like they did, to gather donors like they did, and very, very quickly become the nominee is exactly why she's doing so well. And it's that apparatus that did that for her. I didn't think she was going to be the nominee either. I really didn't. I think there were a lot of forces working against her. The Obamas, as we know, were working against her. And the fact she was able to overcome all of that and her team was savvy enough to, I mean, the way I see it right now is, unless something happens, like, this is hers to lose.
Right. I think the momentum is very clearly there. And I think that any attacks the Republicans have, they're just getting more desperate, right? It's like when you're like, at this point, the attacks that they have are going to get more desperate. They're going to get more misogynistic. They're going to get more racist. They're going to get more bigoted. And it's not going to play well with independents. So every time they come in here and talk about Kamala in a sexual manner and, you know, or a racist manner, I don't even give it breath because it makes them look bad, right? If I'm sitting here having an argument with you, well, then maybe there's some truth to it. There's not. So I don't need to. But I am a bit curious, and maybe you have the answer. What the f- happened with the Kamala campaign? Because Biden's, like, we talked about it on here, in many ways, it's very, I don't know, it's the same people running it. It's pretty much the same campaign just transferred. they were insanely inept. We talked about their lack of debate prep on here and how poorly they did with debate prep for a long time and the messaging, and the list goes on. And it's just like someone flipped a switch of like, really good. We're winning now. Right. Like, that's the switch. And I don't know if you have an insight as to what happened, but you can see it in the Kamala HQ, right? Where there's no virality to anything they posted, anything the Democrats posted, anything Biden posted, nothing, no virality. It wasn't getting any viewership. And now you go into Kamala HQ, it's like, 10 million views, like overnight. So I don't know what they did, like what the deal, like, is this a plan that the Democrats, like, we're just going to send in a bunch of people to help you? I don't know if you have an answer to that, but it was a weird switch.
So I do have power. Some answers for you. And first,
sorry, I just had to throw it in there.
Oh, no worries.
Women power.
Yeah. So first is, and a lot of people in the comments are saying that I'm wrong for saying the Obamas were working against her. It's fairly well known that she is not on great terms with the Obamas. Obviously, like, they're friendly enough. The Obamas preferred Deval Patrick. They preferred alternative options the same way they didn't prefer Joe Biden in 2020. Of course, they endorsed her when they saw the way the winds were blowing, but Obama world themselves were. And when I say the Obama world, it's also his close advisors, all of the people that make up his foundation. They very much were pro Beto in 2020 and didn't support Harris until recently. They coalesced when they saw which way the winds were blowing. And of course, Obama did endorse her, which is good. With her campaign, I think it's twofold, right? One of which is the Biden campaign had a campaign rule saying that Biden had to sign off on all senior staff hires. And especially with his travel schedule, with him getting sick, that was not happening. We know just for a fact that the hiring was extremely slow. The senior campaign hires were slow. They were very overly reliant on a few consultants. They had one guy doing all of their ad work. And the fact is, when you have one guy doing your ad work for a presidential campaign, that is just not okay. When Kamala came in, and mostly the same team, but a lot of it is just like the leadership apparatus and structure changed is part of it. And also part of it is when you're working in politics, and I've worked in politics for almost 10 years now, a lot of what you do with matches the energy level of the candidate. And that's one thing is that, especially like when you're writing tweets for someone, you're doing media, you have to match the candidate's vibe, because otherwise people are never going to think it's the candidate. Like the candidate is never on Twitter. Joe Biden, everyone knows Joe Biden's never doing his own tweets, but you want to match his tone and match his structure. With Kamala, the great thing is she's energetic. She's young, young in quotes, obviously, but like young enough that she can really be out there and have her Kamala HQ, like fun Charlie XCX videos, and be this really energetic candidate. So they were matching her vibe in the digital sphere, which is exactly what we needed. And also the fact that she can run a campaign differently. She's not doing the same rules on hiring. They're hiring, speeding up the process. They're bringing in more ad makers. They're bringing in her staff, who really wasn't involved in the presidential campaign because it was all Biden's staff. They're the same people, but they had lesser roles just doing VP stuff. They're being elevated, and it's really bringing a very young, fresh face to the campaign. Biden had this inner circle of advisors, which are three or four of his advisors for the past 30 years, and they controlled a lot behind the scenes. And it's the same campaign manager, Jen O'Malley Dillon, but she had to go to those advisors to get to Biden, and that's all changed. So really the taking out the bureaucracy apparatus and opening up the campaign, it's opened up a whole world of possibilities, which I'll be honest, I didn't think that would happen because I didn't think they would be allowed to. I thought it would take longer, there'd be a drawn out primary, and it would really be contentious. And the fact that that didn't happen and they allowed her staff to be creative and do what they do best, especially in the digital sphere, has been exactly why you've seen this momentum shift.
Hey guys, if you are enjoying the show, make sure you hit the like, subscribe, and leave a comment down below. And if you want to support the channel, you guys can become a YouTube member on this channel, or preferably join the Patreon in the link tree in the bio. Also in the link tree is my TikTok, Instagram, Twitch, and the OK Hi YouTube, which I post news to on a regular basis. Enjoy the rest of the show. Okay. And one of the other things that I wanted to ask that I thought was really important, I think is going to be important going into this race, is what are your thoughts on the polling that we're seeing? We're seeing some polls where pollsters are outright admitting in their analysis and their methodology that they're not able to contact enough Democratic voters. So they're trying to adjust for that. We're also seeing Democrats continually outperform polls. But historically, we've seen races that Donald Trump is in out where he outperforms, which concerns me a little bit going into the election, because Joe Biden was so much more ahead in 2020 and the race ended up being closer than the polls, not by a lot, but close enough that it was like, at least in the electoral college vote. Do you do we see a continuation of what we've seen the last couple of years post-Dodd, or do you think we're going to see a revert to Donald Trump is running, his base is going to show up to vote for him?
Yeah, that's a great question. Obviously, it's tough because just with polling and the way we've gone is that we're overly reliant right now on online polls. And I'll be the first to say that I'm overly reliant on online polls because we don't have many other alternative options. People aren't picking up landlines, and we know that. But you're totally right. Trump, since the entire time he's been a candidate, has consistently outperformed his polls. There's some theories for that. One's the shy Trump voter where, say, they like wouldn't admit to voting for him. I think that's out the window at this point. You know the Trump supporters. They're not shy. They are wearing their hats. So I don't really buy that one. I'm more by that he's just kind of an electoral force. Like, people show up to vote for Trump because he's inspiring to them, and that's the rural white working class. I think the pollsters have by and large fixed that issue. I think they very much are accounting for his base now. And the reason I say that is in 2020, obviously, like, he did outperform his polls. I think they were better. And I think Trump being on the ballot is no longer the surprise that it was once. Like, this is his third time running for president. Like, it's not surprising anyone. No one's like coming out just to vote for him because he's an inspirational figure. So I think that part's done. I think consistently, like, in my point of view, Democrats are probably being underpolled by about 2%. And the reason I say that is we consistently see crosstabs with a very close race for the 18 to 35 group, or Republicans outright leading the 18 to 35 group. There was a set of Harris polls out today that had that. And I just don't buy that. I do not buy that Donald Trump will win a majority of the 18 to 35 group. There's nothing that could convince me that. We also see in the polls right now, if the election were today, and that's the thing about polls, right, is that they are only a snapshot of the race as of today. They are not predicative. Like, the polls today are not predicting the election in November. They're predicting the election today. And we're seeing that if the election was today, there would be an absolutely seismic shift for minority voters to Donald Trump. I don't really think that's true. I think there probably is going to be a 5-point shift towards Donald Trump from minority voters. What we're seeing today is a 20-point, 25-point shift, and I do not see that bearing out. Whether that's a methodology issue, whether that's a polling issue, I don't know. But I just don't see it. And if anything, we should be hopeful that the polls are probably undercounting Democrats.
Yeah, this is like a really multifaceted issue. And there's a bit of concern there, right? Because we don't really know, which is part of the reason that I want a Beshear in the race and not a Shapiro. We don't really know, right? We can guess. And I think that we've seen it where Democrats have continued to outperform, but we've talked about it here. I've coined it the Bernie Sanders syndrome. There's probably like a psychological thing for this, but Bernie Sanders, his first time through, just energized the shit out of everyone, right? Just like, oh my God, Bernie, right? Bernie, because it was him or Hillary. And the next time around, it was like, Bernie's cool. We love Bernie. Bernie's great. But that fervor died off, right? And so I think that we're seeing that, right? Where it's like the fervor for for Donald Trump is, these people may still support him. Are they going to show up for him? That's the question. And I don't think so. We've also seen pretty substantial shift in the loss of boomers. What is it? 20 million boomers have been lost over the since 2016 or something like that. There was 1.5 million that died of COVID, as well as, or 1.5 million people that died of COVID. And in that batch of people, 60% of them, 66% of them were Republican or right-leaning, right? typically more non-vaccinated, very opinionated people, probably played a role in 2020. But we've seen more shifts, and I don't think that they're going to show up to that degree. I think that we've seen what Roe has done to the voting bloc and the voting base in this country. Inherently, I think the Democrats are going to outperform. But there's still that concern, right? Where it's like, I'm not. But in terms of the polling, I would agree with you. I saw some polls where it was like 30% of the black vote is going to Trump. And I'm like, no, that's not, no. Because in 2020, I think I saw 22%, 24%. And that never materialized. It was like 10% is what it ended up being again. So I don't know what's going on with the polling, but it is making it particularly difficult to read, and that's why I was hoping that you, as a political analyst, could give us some insight to that. So I'm grateful for that, because me being the amateur, it is a bit bit confusing.
The most common question I get on my channel is, Oh, sorry. Yeah, my Wi-Fi cut for a second. The most common question I get on my channel is people saying polling is wrong. Like, I never believe polls. And it's coming from Democrats. And for me, at least, it's mm-hmm. disappointing because we know that polling is imperfect, an imperfect science, of course, but it's important in understanding the race. And the fact remains that we have seen such a substantial shift in the polling towards Harris, we can definitively say that she's a more exciting candidate that will get more of the vote than Joe Biden. And that's what it's important in polling is. I say, follow trends. Don't use it to like when the election is November, no, going back to the polls from today and say these polls were wrong in July because they had Harris winning, if she doesn't or whatever. It's use them for trends and use them to see the general outlay of the election and then try to find good, high quality state pollsters and go from there.
Yeah. Like if you're watching the same polls that were giving her mid to upper 30s, suddenly be like, oh yeah, no, actually all of them are changing to be, no, she's in a head to head heat with Donald Trump. It's probably a good idea of what's happening with the country right now. But you know, as insofar as that being like the Harris polls that were released today that I saw, it's just like, I don't have, was it Donald Trump was up by 4 in the general match? It was like, there's no way. I don't believe that at all. I didn't even go through the methodology. I was just like, they're like way outside the norm. It's just like, it's just probably not even a good idea to factor that in when so many other state polls are showing a head to head heat. But yeah, I don't know. Has anybody on the panel got any questions? Because I think that's most of what I had. I am hoping for Bashir. I did want Shapiro, but I do think Shapiro.
Yeah, I'm happy to take any questions.
I do think Bashir. Yeah, my yeah, I'm curious is to Bashir. Think, I think Bashir's a.
Mm-hmm. I'm curious to know what your thoughts are on the way the Obama's endorsement of Kamala Harris had rolled out.
Yeah, because it was like 5 a.m. in the morning.
Yeah,
I do know that ads accompanied it, but it was such a weird thing. I know they wanted to run ads on like morning news shows and stuff, but it was really weird timing. 5 a.m. Eastern, I think is
when they announced. Honestly, I thought they'd come out with like an entire news cycle with Obama endorsing
it. Right.
And it just really went under the radar. Press statement
or something, a release, but it was just a random video. I was up. It was 2 a.m. my time, and they just dropped a video of them. It seemed very staged, very orchestrated on the phone, and that was it.
Yeah, I don't know if you
And I think that's somewhat a result of the fact that, like I mentioned, the Obamas didn't want to endorse Harris.
Seems like it.
Yeah, it was just a weird timing. I thought like 5 a.m.
The Obamas get on didn't want to have to do it, so they dropped it off cycle.
Man, Obama. Yeah, anyways.
I know. Why did he not just get just get up there and just say, you know, get up onto a major news show and be like, yeah, we're endorsing, or do a teleprompt conference, whatever. But yeah, I thought that could have been utilized better. I think it probably will be going into the convention, but be a team player. Carolyn, appreciate becoming the fan over there. Alan, appreciate the tip over on YouTube. Parker, appreciate it. Carolyn, appreciate the tip over on YouTube as well. Thank you, guys. Squeeze some Dubs and Drumsticks in the chat for them. I'll get to the Venmo Cash app in a second, but I'm just looking out for questions here. Sorry, go ahead.
Did they join any of the Zoom calls by chance?
No.
No? Damn.
No.
So I'll be honest with you. The way I kind of look at all this played out, it was they pulled the old rope-a-dope on them, right? They pretended like Biden was weak for the last 10 months or so, then came out with Kamala with a 1-2 punch and just really leveled them. I think it was a very strategic and well thought out and well executed plan. I was impressed.
It was. I'm happy knowing that there's a bunch of people out there with a whole bunch of... Go ahead.
Oh, no, please. I was just going to say, I don't think it was a plan. I know we're saying that. And I know a lot of people in the Harris orbit, and I know people on the Biden team. This was unexpected. And I know we say that, and like obviously people are like, oh, of course there was a plan, and it rolled up so well. It came together spur of the moment because Democrats were committed to making Kamala Harris the nominee. There was not a well-thought-out plan because, unfortunately, Democrats are not known for our strategic thinking and planning. It came together out of nowhere, yeah. And like, thank God it did come together the way. But Biden was looking bad because he was looking bad. They did not want to go out there and have a bad debate. That was never the plan. Like they prepped obviously badly, wrongly, but yeah. They prepped him for that debate to win it. And the fact that he didn't instrumented what happened, but there was not like some grand plan or something. This really is just sheer dumb luck.
Yeah, I don't think that they. I think it was just I think that the. You know, obviously it was the donor push, but when it came into question, I think in hindsight, it was pretty obvious that when it started coming into question and when Democrats started calling for him to drop out, that it was a money issue and that they had probably fractured his candidacy to such a degree that they weren't going to be able to recover from it. And obviously nobody, like we were having conversation about whether or not it should be Kamala. Now it makes sense, right? Obvious, the money's there, there's no issues with Trump saying, oh, she can't be on the ballot. There's no deadline issues, anything like that. She's already there. But, you know, when she's polling the same as Joe Biden, it doesn't instill a lot of confidence that she's going to be able to make up the gap. So, but no, I think that this worked out for the Democrats, and this worked out in a really, really, really great way. And I think that it's, I think that the kicker here is the Democrats get to pick their VP, and I think the VP is going to play an important role in this election cycle. I don't know. It's just all the chips fell into place, and I think it's pretty amazing that a black woman is about to send Donald Trump to prison twice because Fonnie Willis in Georgia. So, because that's it. Like, that's what he's yeah, go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, I love the fact that there's a lot of people that are stuck with, you know, who God knows how much money worth of, you know, let's go Brandon, fuck Joe Biden flags and merchandise. I love, there's a whole bunch of people stuck with that. And then I am predicting 90 to 92 million. Do you think that's a possibility that we could, that American voters would turn out in those numbers? Because that's my prediction for Kamala.
That is a lot of voters.
It is a lot of voters, but you know, I think women are going to turn the out because, you know, nothing's going to motivate an apolitical woman like taking her health care choices away from her. And I think it will. But, and one more thing, and then I'll shut up and go back on mute because I got a headache. I know it's anecdotal as AF, but my staunch Republican parents both informed me tonight they're voting for Kamala Harris. Woot, woot. Anyway, that's all I had to say.
Nice. Nice. In Alabama. I think, I think 91 is probably too much, but I think that we'll probably, I don't know what the exact numbers will see. Cause 81 was a lot of vote. A lot of 81 million was a lot of votes. I don't know. Could probably see somewhere around there. It just depends. I don't know. I think, yeah, Max.
I'll be honest. I don't even try to track popular vote because like in my world, it doesn't matter all that much. Like she runs up the margin of California, New York, like great for her, but I don't particularly care. Maybe like 85. The question really is it going to be a high turnout election or a low turnout election? I think the conventional wisdom from a lot of people is that Democrats do better in high turnout elections, and I strongly disagree with that. Democrats have become the party of college-educated, high-information voters. Those are voters that are – and that's another reason polls are potentially wrong, because those voters are polled the same amount, say, as other voters, but are much, much more likely to actually vote at the end of the day. I think the Democrats would be best off with a low turnout election, just energized women that hate Donald Trump and want their rights. I think it'll be a medium turnout election for whatever that means. I think that you'll see some states with higher turnout than others. I think Democrats very much hope California and New York are high turnout states because the House depends on it. I don't think you're going to see any sort of record set, and that's just the virtue of it being kind of a weird election, like everything that happened with Biden. There's not an incumbent. We'll see. I think a medium turnout election would be just fine for Democrats.
People who registered to vote absentee or during the COVID to vote by mail, do they have to do that again, or will those people automatically get mail-in ballots going forward? I don't know the answer to that question.
It very much depends on the state. There are some states, like on the West Coast, where you automatically get an absentee ballot no matter what. I would tell everyone to go to their state Secretary of State website and look at the rules. For example, I'm a voter in Ohio. And I will be requesting my absentee ballot, as is the law, 90 days before the election or something. But very much, when in doubt, just go to your Secretary of State's website. Don't mess with anything else. Read it carefully. Do everything you can.
My prediction for this election, I'm not sure what yours is.
I've enjoyed this.
I think I'm gonna see if there's some poll or some people have some questions in the comment section in just a second. And I'll ask you guys. My initial thoughts are right. I thought it was going to be a squeaker of an election. I think that right now, if trend continues, the one I want to see is Arizona. I'm not convinced Arizona, Nevada. Nevada might now, for reasons I'll get to in a second. I'm not convinced Arizona is going to go Democrat. But I think that they're probably going to win most swing states. Nevada had a question where the Trump-supporting Hispanic – or sorry, the Hispanic voters there had moved more towards Trump. However, when Kamala entered the race, that flipped because Joe Biden was polling about 45 to 44 with Hispanic voters among Trump. Now it's about 57 to 38 or something like that, as the numbers I saw with Kamala. So it shifted pretty significantly. So I don't know if Nevada is going to go blue. Inherently, until I see some polls on it, I'm going to say stick with just probably not. But I think that this is going to be a sizable election, a sizable landslide. And I think that Georgia could very well be in play. North Carolina might be. There's just a lot of voter suppression there. I think Kamala's going to win. Yeah, I'm pretty confident she's going to win. We're going to have to see the polls. Obviously, you know, anything can happen. But if it's maintained this trend, she's going to win heavily. And I think down ballot from Republicans is really going to hurt. That's my thoughts there. Yeah, I hope that it's when you're talking about elections, when it comes to Tester in Montana, like I'm hoping that the lack of enthusiasm for Vance Trump causes Kamala to propel him to a win there. Sherrod Brown, who's I think he's winning in his polling. But yeah, I think down ballot for Democrat is going to do better now with Biden out of the race. Not something that I predicted, but I'm glad to be wrong. So anybody got any debates or sorry, any questions for Max on any of the platforms? God help if it's the laughing hyena wins and not the rapist. Okay. I know where your priorities lie. I also think that there's a stark contrast now between like being able to shrug off any bad thing Donald Trump did. And now it's like, what are they going to say when they point out Donald Trump, you're a rapist? He's going to go, what about Hunter Biden? What's he going to say now? Like, what's he going to say? It's just not going to go well for him. Anybody over on TikTok see any questions in the comment section? I'll check. You guys, if you guys want to check over here, I'll check over on TikTok or YouTube and Twitch. You guys want to, the people, my Jaden, want to check on? Max, what are your thoughts about the Electoral College? Should it stay or go? I'm under the volition it should go. I don't understand why we have it. But, well, I understand why we have it. I don't understand why we have it anymore other than to protect Republicans. It basically is affirmative action for Republicans. That's what it's become, interestingly enough. Sorry, Max, on mute right now. I'm busy for a second. Weird is their kryptonite. And I find it weird that they think that weird is the one that stuck. Weird is the one that upsets them. I'm not seeing any questions over on YouTube. We're going to get some debates in here in a minute. I have to do all the catch up on everything over here. How does money affect the presidential race versus Senate race? That's a good question. Oh, Max is still on mute. So typically speaking, in a presidential race, the more money, the more states you can move around and target. It makes the other candidacy nervous, the other camp nervous. Because like if you're going to move money into a state that previously wasn't on the board and the polls are showing it's on the board, you got to sit there and protect it. So you have to allocate resources. But it does, if more money wins Senate races most of the time. Oh, I can't even hear. I was sitting here like, why is no one talking? I was over here looking at the chat. That's not my fault. Don't blame me.
That's funny. Well,
you didn't miss anything.
Sorry, it was a capture card.
If Trump's going to continue to call Kamala, can we start just calling him Donald?
Yeah.
We need to just call him. Every time somebody comes in, we mention Trump, we call him Donald Trump. We just say Donald Trump. And Donald. Every time.
It's Donald.
I don't know if...
Hey, Max, we can hear you now. You can answer the question.
I got a couple questions on Nate Silver and 538.
Oh, there we go.
I think my take is that Nate Silver used to be the best in the business. I think he has sufficiently biased himself into the fact where I don't read him anymore. He has a lot of priors, and the whole point of being a good analyst is you don't let your priors affect your current predictions and anything you're doing. And when I do actual analysis, when I'm getting paid to do analysis, all of my personal thoughts are gone. I don't care. I solely focus on the election, and I think that's what Nate used to do, and I think he lost that. There's been a lot of criticism of the new 538, the one without him. I happen to like it. I think they have a fairly good model. People were freaking out and hating on them when Biden was ahead, when it was Biden-Trump, and he was the last. It was the only model where Biden was ahead. I tend to think that I agreed with the model. Up until the last day, I still agreed that Biden, I thought, was going to be Trump. I thought it was going to be incredibly close and come down to like 15 votes. But I don't fault that model. I think... For what it's worth, it's very hard to find people that are trustworthy to listen to in this environment. When it comes to analysis, when you look, a lot of people always bring up to me Alan Lichtman, who's the guy with the 13 keys.
Oh, yeah. I was going to ask you about
that. He's junk. He's absolute junk science. Do not listen to a word he says. Any serious person does not listen to him because he's a social scientist who only talks about sociology. But when it comes to like polling and stuff, like just look at the numbers yourselves. You can be your own analyst. Read polling numbers, understand them, look at cross tabs. It takes a little bit, but it's a fun like side activity if you're already involved. And if you don't care that much about politics, just read 538 or whatever.
Yeah, I was getting Alan Lichtman comments. I never bothered to look into it. Because it's always one of those things where it's like, you know, there's multiple different people that do that in multiple different models. And if you have thousands of people doing it over elections, some of them are bound to be right, you know, more often than not, obviously for other confounders than the ones that they're pointing out. But I got sent the article of Nate Silver talking about he's giving Donald Trump a 60-something% chance of winning the Electoral College, which is just like, if you're taking the aggregate of all the polling right now, sure, maybe. But if you're ignoring the fact that Kamala's coming up on this and taking Pennsylvania is so critical to either campaign that, you know, why are we even having a discussion about Donald Trump? There's no way that he's up 69 points or 69, you know, like there's no way that 69% chance he's going to take the Electoral College if he's losing Pennsylvania. It's just not possible. And so I actually sent that to Jaden today where I sent a voice memo because he sent, and I was like, it's just not possible. Because if you win Pennsylvania, mm-hmm. you're halfway there. Well, you're not halfway there, but you're close. You're more than likely to win the, and it just doesn't make sense with Kamala being up in Pennsylvania in multiple polls now to say that Donald Trump is the favorite. Bogus. Like, I don't know. Nate, I used to respect Nate a lot. I don't know what happened to him, but I just go to 538 for the polls now and when they're released, because for some reason, different pollsters aggregate different, release different ones. And so ones included on RCP is not going to be included on, for some reason, sometimes there's differences, so I just go and check. But I don't know what happened to Nate Silver. Just because you've been right in the past doesn't mean... undercounting Pennsylvania to that degree is a problem. So
yeah, I got like one more minute if you have any last questions for me.
I think I didn't see any over here. Somebody asked really quick about the Electoral College and whether she'd get rid of it. Cause I didn't hear it. If you had answered it.
She's not, there's no mechanism for her to, no, Electoral College will stay.
Oh no. Should we get rid of it? I think is what.
Should we get rid of it? Yeah. I mean, should we get rid of the Senate? Yeah, like if you want to go the route of things we should have, we shouldn't have a Senate, we shouldn't have an Electoral College, we shouldn't have a Supreme Court with unlimited lifetime appointments with no recourse. There's a lot of stuff that even if we get rid of a filibuster, we can talk about doing. Like DC should have statehood, Puerto Rico should have statehood. All of that is on a very long list of things that we should and could be doing that will be possible if this goes really, really, really well in a way that Kamala made possible.
Yeah, I've talked about the Democrats need to start. My uncle used to say this. He's like, and if you have to go, that's fine. You can just drop out if you need to go. But my uncle used to say this. He goes, one thing, he's like, some people like to play fucky fucky. And he goes, I like to play fucky fucky and I'm better at it. Right. And the Democrats don't like to do that. They like to play like this, you know, this political game of feeling like they're superior morally and then get their kicked out of them in the procedural ways. I think they need to stop doing that. I think they should say, fuck it, stack the court, fuck the Republicans. They don't have any. Why? We don't owe them anything. Stack the court, then fix the show that they've created over the last however many years, and then offer them maybe a rotation. Make DC and Puerto Rico state. It's the problem with
where we go high, we go low. That's a huge problem because it didn't work. We lost. Mm-mm. I don't want to go high. I want to win because I want to help people. Like the Democratic Party has a platform that will help the American people in a way the Republican Party will not. End of the day, you don't need to go high to do that. You need to win.
Right. Stack the court, make states, the Republicans over in every way imaginable. So that way that they're coming back to us when they want to make a deal and it's on their knees. And then we can operate from a position of power. But saying, oh, we're just going to, you know, that's not operating from a position of power, but. Anyway.
Yeah, and they can hate us for it, but at the same time, it'll end up like Obamacare. The fact of the matter is what Obamacare did was expand Medicaid and Medicare, and it's uniquely popular. Even red states have expanded Medicare because it's so popular. At the end of the day, we are helping them, and they'll realize it eventually. They may not realize it by name, but they'll know. Things will change for the better, and it'll be impossible to separate that from the Democrats running the country.
I agree. Well, Max, like your cat is hungry, but I appreciate you coming in.
She's very upset. Sorry about that.
No, you're good. I appreciate you coming in. I suspect that we'll have more conversations in the future over this. And yeah, let's hope the Democrats can figure this out.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks so much for having me. It was great talking to you all. Thank you for all the comments. Yeah, have a good one.
All right, take care, Max. By the way, I want to point out, on election night, when I was pretty convinced that the Democrats were going to win because of a red mirage coming in, right, where the mail-in ballots were not being counted at the rate because we're just overloading these centers. I shot Max a text and was like, what do you think about the states? And he basically like, people on the ground are telling me it's done. The Democrats are probably going to win. So even when the polling, whenever I was catching a bunch of shit for saying that Biden was going to still pull through, I was like, I can't remember when it was, probably like 10 o'clock at night or something. I showed him a text. He's like, nah, they think they have enough ballots to win. So, he's a great resource. I'll be hitting him up on election night. He'll probably be in here on election night to some degrees. And yeah, it's going to be fun. I love election night. Love it. Love it. Love the days leading up. Love election night on every level though. And it's the first time we covered the midterms in here. This will be the first time we cover the presidential election in this kind of setting. Because last time, like, you guys, for those of you that were watching it, I had to get off live and I had to go look over the information coming in. And then I had to come back on live and show you guys and then leave and come back. And it was a nightmare. It's going to be the first time I'm on live during a presidential election. It's high stakes. High stakes. So.
Yeah. What are we going to drink when we win?
Oh, I'm going to buy a super... Nah, probably not going to buy an expensive bottle because, let's be real, I don't like alcohol like that. But, you don't know.
Should we place bets that night? Easy money.
No, they never pay. They never do.
I know, but still. It's nice to think.